Re, TEACHERS Janine Interlandi wrote about the low wages paid to preschool teachers and whether improving their training and their pay would improve outcomes for their students. The answer to the question set forth in Janine Interlandi's article Why Are Our Most Important Teachers Paid the Least? Is obvious, economics. Private preschool is a huge industry in the United States. The goal seems to be to squeeze as much from middle-class parents as possible. Better neighborhoods have better preschools and higher costs, but for many working-class Americans, the only choices are the unlicensed caregiver down the street or a family member. We have no vision as a society, as we would rather invest our dollars building bases around the world and blowing money on walls. Nev Gill, Dayton, Ohio, on NewYorkTimes.com. This article brought up the unjust truth, the social, economic, and educational divide across the country starts when children are very young. The article does a wonderful job of presenting the challenges and the reality of many preschool teachers, which I hope we can continue to address. Demanding jobs that are done well deserve respect, and that includes living wages. The bottom line is that fixing this issue will require respect, respect for the children. Respect for preschoolers' social, cognitive, emotional, and physical growth. And, of course, respect for preschool teachers, who are not in the field for the money. Pamela Evans, Charlottesville, Virginia. Thank you for Janine Interlandi's insightful and well-researched study of early childhood education. As first a teacher and then a union representative of teachers in the Springfield, Massachusetts, area, I was impressed by how well her article captured the reality. Teachers like Kijo Kelly work incredibly hard for poverty wages. They are entrusted with developing the next generation of citizens, yet they are provided with no resources. The things we have tried: academic studies of the field, proclamations of how important young children are, requiring teachers to have degrees they can't afford, and drowning teachers in paperwork have only made matters worse. What we need is a serious investment in courageous teachers like Kijo. Living wages, affordable, accessible education opportunities for teachers, and qualified support staff, speech language, occupational therapy, and counseling. Providing high-quality education to young children would provide many long-term benefits to society, but it would cost money. This would be a much wiser and more loving choice than tax breaks for the rich. Brooks Ballinger, Amherst, Massachusetts. Like the teacher in Janine Interlandi's article, I took a pay cut to become a preschool teacher. It shouldn't be necessary to make a financial sacrifice to take on a job that is among the most valuable in our country. We live in a country where we will happily spend billions on football stadiums and weapons systems but won't spend a few thousands on our young people. We miss the point that our future lies in providing education and opportunity to our young. Rich language and thinking skills and abundant opportunities to apply those skills are our most valuable weapons systems. These are the tools on which we can build a prosperous future. But we've got to invest now. Craig Overbeck, Fayetteville, N.Y.RE. Pencils. Christopher Payne and Sam Anderson went inside one of the world's last pencil factories. I am a teacher, so I see my students interact with pencils daily. Many students have writing tool preferences, and I see a sad trend that many are moving to the mechanical pencil. Watching these ratcheting graphite guns replace the perfected design of the classic yellow number 2 is yet another reminder of how many are losing touch with intimate interactions with the natural world, even if it is through bringing form to thoughts using dead wood and a little carbon. Great photo essay. Dan Cafader, Wilmington, Del, on NewYorkTimes.com. He grew up in Jersey City, less than a mile away from General Pencil, and the factory was a cornerstone of the Jersey City Heights area. Everyone knew someone who worked or had worked there, and as Jersey City went through its ups and downs in the 70s and 80s, my parents often said that it was one of the few businesses willing to stay committed to the city and its employees. This was a fascinating look into a world that I would have never imagined to be as unique and colorful as these pictures portray. Thanks for bringing back and enriching so many memories. Donna Loftus, Colleyville, Texas.